Okay, so thank you very much for a chance to speak here. The title of my talk is indeed Categorification in Knot Theory and Physics. And maybe I thought I might start with a question if anyone has worked on this so-called categorification, or have you heard this word before? Because I must say, at least, okay, some people have heard, but I'm not sure if everyone. So my aim is to try to explain what categorification means and give you some examples. Well, in fact, this is quite intuitive, so probably you may guess. Let me just say that this was formulated by Crane around 1995. And let me stress that even though this sounds very mathematical, because the word category is embedded in this word categorification, it has a lot to do with physics, because this idea appeared in the paper whose title is Clock and Category is Quantum Gravity Algebraic. So we again find this word quantum gravity, which appeared already in two previous talks, which is quite characteristic. And there is another paper from more or less the same time by Crane and Frankel. The title is longer, but it starts with four-dimensional topological quantum field theories and so on, which already indicates relations to physics. So somehow this is, let's say, another area where it seems that physics is quite important and gives some inspiration to mathematics. So just in one word or one sentence, this categorification is supposed to be a process which allows to find one would say category theoretic analogs of set theoretic ideas. So this is what is quite often done, maybe not necessarily using this word, but well, the idea is to assign to sets, or maybe some spaces like vector spaces, some categories, to assign to functions between sets certain functors, to equations between elements of the set certain isomorphisms, and so on. So just roughly speaking. And well, the inverse process could be called, or it is called, simply decategorification. And just to give you a very simple example, when we consider the set of natural numbers, it can be categorified into a category of finite sets. Such that, well, the objects here are, of course, just sets, and in this case, morphisms are functions between sets, and addition or multiplication between natural numbers become respectively disjoint union or tensor, well, Cartesian product, And then decadal coryphication. Is simply taking the number of elements in a set. So this sounds quite obvious, but of course there are a lot of other examples and considerations which are more more complicated. Maybe yet another example. Let's say this is example one. Another example, it will be quite important in what follows, is example of Betti numbers. So as you know, Betti numbers, roughly speaking, are some numbers which tell you how many holes of certain dimension there are in a manifold. And you might know that these Betti numbers can be found as ranks of homology groups. So in a way you can go from Betti numbers to some more complicated structure like homology groups, or also some complexes of vector spaces. And this step is this replacing of simple numbers by this homology groups is an example of categorification. So the question is whether this is some universal process or how can it be described formally. I will not be going into very much formal definitions, but rather try to give you some more examples in what follows. But already at this stage, let me stress that it has some flavor of physics and could be thought of as some counterpart of quantization. In a sense that in quantization, when we consider quantization, we also go from a kind of simple objects like functions into more complicated objects like operators, which act on some vector spaces like Hilbert spaces. And in fact, quantization is not quite a unique process, which is also, you may already see, categorification is also not unique. If you start with natural numbers, there are many ways to find categorical generalizations, which might be relevant in some particular situation in you consider. So there is some ambiguity, and the question is how to make this ambiguity as small as possible, one might say. So one way, at least for physicists, to think of this categorification is as analog of quantization. And there is yet another catalog which also makes contact with physics, which is even more accurate, namely dimensional, categorification will be like going higher in dimensions, or the categorification would correspond to dimensional reduction. And this indeed can be made much more precise in the context of topological quantum field theories. So you may know that topological quantum field theories have also a lot to do with categories. In what follows, I will refer to them as TQFTs. And in this context of topological quantum field theories, this categorification is a process of assigning n plus 1 dimensional TQFT to n dimensional TQFT. There are various examples of topological quantum field theories. I will list some in a moment. And then indeed it makes sense to try to find higher dimensional one to a given TQFT. So in this context, this categorification has to do with the changing of that dimension. And moreover, here you can already see that we can have the whole tower of such categorifications. We can go higher and higher into dimensions, and then we should get more and more, let's say, complicated or abstract incarnations of categories. So this dimensional, the whole ladder of dimensions is indeed referred to as dimensional ladder. And it could be of particular interest for those who are interested in quite abstract formulation of categories. So my talk will be mainly in the context of the topological quantum field theories. I will write examples in a moment, but before I do that, in case you have not worked with this or are not very familiar, let me say one sentence or two sentences what topological quantum field theory is, at least in one formulation. More precisely, let's say n-dimensional topological quantum field theory is a functor, if you want to use categorical language, let me denote it by f, which take us from the category of, in this context, n-dimensional cobordisms into category of vector spaces, or physicists would say some category of Hilbert spaces. Of course, with some additional conditions, in particular such a condition that composition of cobordisms lifts to composition of maps between vector spaces. Maybe I should say a bit more precisely that this TQFT, well, it assigns let me write it here, this f to n minus one dimensional manifold assigns a vector space, and then to a cobordism, which is like a map between two n minus one dimensional manifold, it assigns some linear map between these vector spaces, and then, well, in such a way that this condition is satisfied. So typically one makes such a picture. We have some n minus one dimensional manifold, another such manifold, and then this cobordism is something one dimensional higher, so in this case that would be, well, if you would have two-dimensional TQFT, we would have one-dimensional manifolds, just loops, and then cobordism would be those two-dimensional open manifolds. And then TQFT assigns to this one-dimensional manifold some vector space, and then to a cobordism, a map between vector spaces is assigned. So in particular, you may consider n minus one dimensional manifold, which is just a point. In that case, say empty set, in that case this functor assigns to it just the ground field. So if you have general n minus one dimensional manifold that what is assigned to this is the vector space. If this is just empty space, then we assign just the ground field over which this vector space is constructed. Which means or implies that if we consider closed n-dimensional manifold, we found boundaries. Then we can think of this also as a cobordism between two empty manifolds to which two numbers are assigned. So then this cobordism becomes just a number, which tells you how to go from one number to another number. So it means that this two closed n-dimensional manifold, we associate just a number, and this number is called by physicists a partition function. And now you can see how this categorification works in this context of TQFTs. Let me say that let's start with three-dimensional TQFT. This is the gadget which would assign to two-dimensional manifolds vector spaces and to closed three-dimensional manifolds just numbers, which are those partition functions. And on the other hand, if you would find corresponding four-dimensional topological quantum field theory, this would be something that associates to three-dimensional manifolds vector spaces and then associates also some numbers partition functions to four-dimensional manifolds. So you see that if you go higher in the dimension from the three-dimensional TQFT to four-dimensional TQFT, then instead of associating numbers to three-dimensional manifolds, you assign to them vector spaces. So this is this context in which categorification appears in TQFTs. So the question is how to go from numbers to some more involved structures. And of course, these numbers which appear here, or these partition functions, are supposed to be dimensions of, or appropriately defined dimensions of, these vector spaces which appear here. So I will hope I will manage to show one example of that. But let me just say that in one of these papers which I mentioned in the very beginning, the conjecture was formulated that there exists four-dimensional TQFT, which categorifies some particular three-dimensional TQFT, which is called Chern-Simons theory. And moreover, this four-dimensional TQFT in classical limit reduces essentially to general relativity. So this is an attempt to give a mathematical formulation of what quantum gravity could be. So this conjecture has not been proven until now, or this four-dimensional TQFT has not been found. But of course, this is a very interesting object in itself. for two reasons. One reason is this physical motivation that it should provide some proper formulation of quantum gravity. But another reason why this is interesting is that this theory would produce some invariants of four-dimensional manifolds, and people have hoped that that would be some new invariants which are possibly stronger than the invariants that we know now. And as you probably know, finding invariants of four manifolds, in particular smooth structures, is quite a challenging task. So for mathematicians, this is also a very important motivation to study those TQFTs. So what I'm going to say a few words about is, well, not quite about this four-dimensional TQFT, but rather about this three-dimensional TQFT, which is called Chern-Simons theory, because this is a theory which is interesting in itself. And moreover, this has very close connections with knot theory. And in fact, also within this theory and in the context of knots, this is possible to give yet another very interesting example of categorification. So let me now tell you a few words about this Chern-Simons theory as a topological quantum field theory. Well, for those who are physicists, I could write, and I will write, the action of this theory. So first of all, this is a gauge theory. So this is, let's say, somehow analogous to Maxwell theory or Young-Mills theory. A difference is, of course, that the action looks different. This is not Maxwell action or Young-Mills action, but well, it does this form. A is the gauge field. You can think of this as the algebra valued one form on some manifold. You can see that it has to be three-dimensional just from the structure of this action. A is one form. So the only way to make sense of that is to take this integral over some three-dimensional manifold. And what is quite important is that this action does not depend on the metric explicitly. You may recall that you may write Young-Mills or Maxwell action in a very compact form, roughly speaking, like this, where f is so-called field strength. And in the Young-Mills action, you have the hot star, which captures the information about the metric on the manifold. But this action does not depend on a metric in any explicit way, so you might hope that various quantities which you compute in this theory also do not depend on the metric, and for this reason they have a chance to be topological. And then that was written in a very famous work, which also was one ingredient of why he got Fields Medal. He realized that it is very useful to consider this Chern-Simons theory as a quantum theory, which means that what you want to do is to consider path integral. This is what quantization means, at least according to physicists. So instead of considering this classical action, you consider all possible field configurations. And what you would like to do is to compute a kind of integral over all these possible field configurations. What you do in classical physics, you just look at stationary points of your action, and you are interested in classical configurations, which means these are these configurations, those, let's say, gauge fields, which are stationary points. But here we want to consider all points, make some path integral over all these field configurations. Of course, there are mathematical problems with defining that, but this viewpoint has very interesting also conceptual advantages. So once we compute this integral, we get a number, and this is this number which I referred to as the partition function before. Maybe let me stress what this number depends on. So of course it depends on the free manifold we are considering, because this free manifold is hidden here. It depends, well, let me take units where h bar is equal to 1, but it still depends on this parameter k. It depends on the gauge group which we are considering. Well, and it seems to be all that it may depend on. So from the viewpoint of TQFT, what is the most important is that this partition function, or this number, gives us some quantity which is assigned to this free manifold. And because this action did not depend on the metric, there is a hope that if you define this properly, that this whole integral also will not depend on the metric, and therefore this will be a topological invariant of this three-dimensional manifold. So this is how physicists formulate this Chern-Simons theory. There are, of course, more rigorous mathematical formulations, but it's good to have this in mind, because it also gives a nice interpretation of knot invariants. So now I would like to jump to this last part of the topic of my talk, which is knot theory. And with this preparation, this is quite simple. I suppose you all know that knot theory is a branch of mathematics whose aim is to classify all knots. And what mathematicians do, they associate some so-called knot invariants . Of course, this is very difficult to manipulate with knots. If you have a string in a space, the question is whether two different knots are equivalent, which means that if you have this knot and some other one, which is possibly very complicated, can you move those strands in such a way that this becomes identical to this one without cutting them? So mathematicians would like to have some tools which enable you to do that without playing with knots, but maybe with some simpler objects, and those knot invariants are examples of some objects. So one simple invariant is the number, let's say minimal number of crossings. If you have a given knot, if you manipulate with that, you try to make the number of crossings, like here are three, as small as possible, and then this is some invariant associated to a knot. But of course, this is quite poor. So you need more powerful invariants. And there are so-called knot polynomials, in particular Jones polynomial or Homfli-PT polynomial, which you can compute algorithmically. If you have such a picture of a knot, then you can analyze these crossings, you made some computations, and you get a polynomial which characterizes this knot. This is called Homfli-PT, where P stands for Przetycki and T for Traczyk, who is in the math department of the university. And, well, in a sense, you can think of these polynomials as, these are polynomials, but they are quite close to being numbers. So Jones polynomial is a polynomial in one variable Q. Just to give you an example, for trefoil knot, this is trefoil knot, and this is denoted as 3-1, where 3 means this number of crossings, which is 3 in this example. So in this case, it has the following form. This is just a polynomial. And first of all, it turns out now that it can be computed by this Chern-Simons theory as well. I can write a formula. This is what Witten did in this paper. it turns out that this polynomial arises as the so-called, well, expectation value of the Wilson loop. So we would like to compute similar path integral, but now we would like to put something here which encodes information about this node. So what we put here is a trace of so-called Wilson loop, which is the exponent of the integral. What we can do with this one form A, we can integrate it over some closed curve, which in particular can be some node. So from this viewpoint, this J, well, it depends. If you look now at this path integral, it will depend on similar objects like here. So on a free manifold, this number k, and in fact this dependence on k translates to dependence on q. There is some relation between these two parameters. But apart from depending on this free manifold and the gauge group, this will also depend on this k, on this knot along which we integrate. So we then showed that because this is topological theory, by doing such a path integral, you get well, a polynomial which is assigned to a knot, and this agrees with Jones polynomial, which was formulated a few years earlier in 1984 by Jones. So this was quite a big surprise. And now you see why this viewpoint is very useful. So first of all, it gives you three-dimensional viewpoint on knot invariants. Mathematicians like Jones and others always defined knot invariants just from these two-dimensional diagrams. So they had to make some choice, and they could do computations only from this two-dimensional viewpoint. From Chern-Simons theory, you have three-dimensional interpretation. This is one advantage. And also, you get immediate generalization of knot invariants, well, to of this Jones polynomial, for example, to other invariants. For example, you can change this gauge group. So Jones polynomial corresponds to this gauge group being just SU2, but you can consider any other gauge groups, and then you have very whole generalization of knot invariants. And also this gives you generalization of knot invariants to other manifolds. So of course Jones polynomial was formulated just for R3. So let me say that this is Jones, well, this is for SU2 and also for R3, but from Chern-Simons viewpoint, it doesn't matter that much. You can take any free manifold, whatever topology it has, and you also get knot invariants. So this is how those knot invariants can be interpreted from physics viewpoint. And then finally, to make contact with categories and categorification, let me say that, well, there was one puzzle for many years, which you can already infer from this line, namely why the coefficients in this Jones polynomial are integer. From the definition given by Jones, this is completely not obvious, and in principle here you might have some rational numbers or even this object from original definition. At first sight you might think that it is rational function, not just finite polynomial with finite coefficients. And there was quite a big breakthrough around the year 2000 made by Kovanov, who realized that you can write Jones polynomial as a kind of Euler characteristic associated to some chain complex of vector spaces. So he managed to define, as I say, these are some vector spaces whose, if you consider such an expression which looks more or less like Euler characteristic of some chain complex. And this is why I also mentioned Betti numbers in the very beginning, because you may also recall that in general you can write the Euler characteristic as an internating sum of Betti numbers, which are dimensions of homology groups. So you see that this expression has the same form. Well, one difference is that we have this additional variable here, but it only amounts to the fact that instead of just vector spaces, you have to consider graded vector spaces, and then the grading is labeled or measured by this parameter Q. So you may say that those complexes of vector spaces constructed by Kovanov provide categorification of Jones polynomial. And this raised a lot of interest and new developments in knot theory. It turns out that you can think of those vector spaces also as some knot invariants, which are more powerful than the standard Jones polynomials. They can distinguish more knots, for example. And finally, my time is running out, so I can just say it in words. It also turns out that you can leave this idea of categorification in this knot theory context, or provide some interpretation of these spaces, also from physics viewpoint, if you go from quantum field theory, like this Stern-Simons theory, to string theory. And in that case, it turns out that these spaces are interpreted as Hilbert spaces of some particular states, which you can realize in so-called D-brain systems in string theory. So this is why this is also interesting to physicists. So these are certain Hilbert spaces associated to D-brains, and well, I'm afraid I would need another slot to explain in more details what this means, which I don't have. Let me just say once more that this categorification in this context has some physical interpretation as well, and now this is quite an active area of studies, so if anyone is invited, I'm happy to discuss more, and I think that's all I could say, so thank you. Depends on the context. You can, of course, consider also.
So this is a particular setting, and a general setting is to consider the bundle instead of.
Yes,
the
sure. Yeah.
In two-dimensional technology, we probably have full classification.
There are Frobenius algebras which like label or possible two-dimensional. I don't think we have any classification. We have some examples, but.
But do you expect some non-linear correspondence between complication of PQST in higher dimension, or there are some peculiar dimension of PQST where we expect greater complication than in higher dimension? Do you have any idea about such behavior?
Well, I don't know. I don't have. It seems that the higher in dimension you go, it might be more complicated, of course. But it's like, well, with classification of n-dimensional manifolds, four-dimensional manifolds are somehow special. For other dimensions, it's kind of easier. So, also regarding quantum field theories. Also, different things happen in different dimensions. For example, there is a class of these theories, a bit more general, but somehow it has some flavor of TQFTs, namely conformal field theories. And they are exactly solvable in two dimensions because they have much larger symmetry than in other dimensions. I'm not sure if this is a good analogy, but somehow the fact that in two dimensions there are these Frobenius algebras which label two-dimensional TQFTs, well, it could be some analogy that there are conformal field theories in two dimensions which are solvable. In higher dimensions, it doesn't happen. So that's also why it might be that beyond two dimensions, this classification is very hard. And
Thank you. also another point. You mentioned also about conventional invariants doing this way. Do you have any information about progress in this direction?
Yes. In a sense, well, not groundbreaking progress. I can give you some references, or well, you can search, I don't know, a paper by at least two authors, Argukov and Wafa, from this or previous year. They had maybe two papers. So one of them is about finding, like, categorifying invariants of free manifolds, which would be, at least it is supposed to be, a step towards finding this four-dimensionality QFT.
So, thank you very much.